I think we can already start. So a very warm welcome to my talk. It's a pleasure to be here in ACM CCS in this very beautiful city on this fantastic conference. And it's an honor for me, of course, to speak here. And in my talk today, it's about the dreams and nightmares when doing embedded security. So for example, you have this blonde lady here from Vienna, and she's using modern technology like wireless stuff, contactless cards or remote controls, say to access her house, to access her car, or to do payments, and she would be unhappy if someone else could access her house. And in the past years, I have security analyzed several commercial products for this purpose. And today I would like to share some of my experience with you. And the talk will be rather practical, so should be entertaining and fun just before lunch. Should not be so heavy, so I omitted all equations and complicated formula, but I still hope there will be some interesting content for you. So I'm from Bochum in Germany. Who has ever been to Bochum in Germany? Great, there's a few hands. This is a picture from my childhood. Yeah, there were the coal miners and steel workers, and the air was black, yes. Coal dust. Yeah. Today, meanwhile, they have built the University of Bochum. Yeah. The smoke is gone, the coal dust is gone, and we have a university. That's where I studied electrical engineering and information technology. And then with my PhD thesis, I got on the wrong path and did cryptography and IT security. And during my studies, we had a lot of heavy industry in Bochum. We had Nokia. They closed 2008 to make more profit. Somewhere they moved it to Hungary, I think. Same happened to Opel. Opel was closed 2015. So we have lots of unemployed people in Bochum. So we said we have to do something about it, and we founded Kasper&Oswald. So with David Oswald together, so far we have already 7 employees, so there is still some work for us to do. And we do the research, security analysis, we develop products, we help people with products, the typical consulting stuff. And we also like publicizing, and some of our publications I will summarize in this talk. It's mostly about embedded systems. Some embedded systems are depicted here. For example, a bank card or a car key. I say here a car is probably the most complex and at the same time most insecure embedded system we are aware of. So it's about computers without fans. No? Embedded systems are computers without fans. And obviously all these devices here on the screen, they require security, they require cryptography. Say the bank does not want you to upload credit, no? That you write some credit onto your bank card on your own. Or a car key or car immobilizer should not be possible to copy this immobilizer. So they all require cryptography or security. And in the world of cryptographers, we know about this important circle, that there is the designer or the cryptographer on the one side. He invents something, for example, a cipher. And on the other hand, we have always the attacker, the cryptanalyst. He has a look at this cipher, at this invention. He tries to find security vulnerabilities and flaws. And he reports it to the designer, so the designer can react. And this is the way how to make, on the long term, very secure products or theoretic stuff, ciphers, whatever. That's why we have the AES, right? Because it was published a long time ago, and no one, except for Andrei Bogdanov, was able to break it. And we are today on the side of the attackers. I just want to stress here that it's not about being evil or destroying something or something bad, but it's about making the world secure in the long term. You have to understand the perspective of the attacker in order to invent good security, in order to make secure products. And while in the world of mathematicians, this process is for a long time well known, attacking commercial products is only, I would say, common since about 10 years. People attack commercial products. This is the point when you take any cipher, say a secure cipher, insecure cipher, and you put it into an electronic product, say into this car key that I'm now using to put the next slide. And our specialty is the implementation attacks. I will now explain you implementation attacks, how it works. So this is the parking space of the professors at the Ruhr University in Bochum. And for 10 years, this is my car, and there's a barrier, and it's closed. And then I could not access the parking space of the professors. But as engineer, you can see these pins are not so close together. And there is an implementation attack, no? So the idea is There is a barrier. In theory, it prevents you from entering the parking space, but there is an implementation flaw so that you can park it. And that's also my parking space. You see the big cars of the professors, they will not fit into this parking space. No? Of course, we do not attack parking spaces or barriers, but we attack electronic chips, electronic circuits. And here is an example. You can, for example, etch open the silicon die, and then you can use lasers to shoot on it, and you make fault injection, or you can reverse engineer the hardware or software of this chip, which is usually invasive and destroying the device in a way. And then there is also the technique of side channel analysis, where you basically the device is operating under normal conditions and you observe some physical characteristics. And we are always after the cryptographic key. Usually when you can somehow extract the cryptographic key, then you can manipulate or clone remote controls or charge your credit card and so on. Right, and to start with embedded devices, a good example is always the remote controls and door locks. So I usually explain it with doors, opening doors, but you can transfer what I explain to many other products in the embedded world. So happens if this girl from Vienna, if she presses on her remote control in order to open, say, her car? Long, long time ago, this was a fixed code system. So it's unidirectional, only the remote control can send to the car. And every time you press on the remote control, it sends the same password to the car. And if the car receives this password, it will open. No? This is, of course, very good. It was used, for example, in the first Daimler cars when they had infrared remote controls. Then you could go to the shop, buy a universal remote control for a television, make a copy for your friend, and your friend could also open the car. You know, this was a feature or at the same time a bug, because there could also come the attacker. This is Oscar, the attacker. He can eavesdrop this password and then replay it to the car, and then he can open your car and put something inside. That's of course, but it's still widespread, fixed code systems. On the left-hand side, you have a typical example of a garage door opener. You can see these dip switches. There are 10 dip switches. And of course, most people, when they buy such a remote control, they will leave all the dip switches in the position 0000. But say people would change this code, then there are, 2 to the 10, 1024 possibilities for this fixed code. You can imagine it's not so, it doesn't take really long to try all possible 1,000 combinations one after another. Usually it takes a minute or 1.5 minutes to try all these combinations, and then the door will open. Then you have these, remote control power sockets. Maybe you have, who has got one of these at home? Not so many. In Germany, we like them. We have big competition around Christmas. People start putting these things to switch on and off their Christmas tree lights and so. And then there is a competition, well, because they all set it to the same frequency, to the same code, to the same fixed code, and then they will switch off the neighbor's Christmas tree, and the neighbor will switch, but at the same time, he will switch off the other neighbor's Christmas tree. And there's a, if you are in Germany around Christmas, then you can see all the windows. This is fixed code systems. And of course, industry has reacted to this, and they have invented the rolling code systems. Rolling code systems is now still unidirectional. The remote control only sends to the car. But they're using cryptography, symmetric cryptography. The two golden keys here indicate the crypto. And if you press, and it's intelligent. If you press on the remote control, it can count, +1, +1. And not so intelligent, but it can count. And that's what it actually does. So it sends, for example, the number 124 here, encrypted to the car. The car decrypts the number and opens. The next time you press on the remote control, it will send the number 125. Now the car checks whether 125 is a higher number than 124. And then it will open, all right? If the attacker now comes and he eavesdrops the code with the 125 and replays it to the car, then the car will not open because the car expects 126, 127, and so on. This is an explanation of rolling codes, and it's a good idea to open for opening purposes, for example, because you save on the receiver in the remote control. and you save on the transmitter in the car. So it's good for battery life and for cost. And from mathematical point of view, the ciphertext always remains in the remote control, right? You only get the plain text, the counter, is only in the remote control. The 124, 125 is never available to the attacker. The attacker only gets ciphertext. So in principle, a good idea, but there are attacks, no? And attacks are usually have two options. When we attack commercial products, there are usually two things that we attack. Either we attack the key management. So where do these golden keys come from? No? If there is a flaw in this key distribution, then it might be possible to attack this system even if a good cipher is used. Or you attack the cipher directly. If it's a weak cipher, it might be possible to attack the crypto and then extract the cryptographic keys by attacking the crypto. These are the two options, and we will cover both options in the following slides to come. So long, long time ago, this was my first crypto paper, 2008, Santa Barbara, beautiful. And it was the first time that a side channel attack was used to attack a commercial product. So I quickly summarize for those five people of you that do not know side channel attacks yet. Side channel attacks are like this. You have this safe, you want to open the safe, and you can try now this combinational lock, all possible combinations, and grow a very long beard and get very old, and you will not be able to open it. And a professional thief, as you know from television, takes a stethoscope, right? It works with safes until 1943, and then you can hold the stethoscope to the safe and find the first position, and it makes a mechanic, it makes some noise, yeah? If the first correct position, make a click, and you know, I found the first correct number. Then you go to the other side and makes click again. So you use the side channel of the sound to open the safe. And it's divide and conquer, no? So you, instead of searching 1 million possibilities, you search 3 times 100 possibilities, no? So the search space is a lot smaller. And that's exactly what we do with chips, because today the secrets are not in the safe anymore, but today they are, the secret data is in little chips, for example, in smart cards. And then the stethoscope is useless. You need an oscilloscope, for example, to observe the physical observables. For example, the electromagnetic emanation, the power consumption, the runtime of the device. And usually the assumption is just that there is a difference visible between processing a 1 and a 0. And if this difference can be seen, then side channel attacks usually work. Huh? So, and this applies to all unprotected devices. No matter what cipher is implemented, you watch, for example, the power consumption, and there will be a way to extract the secret key from watching it, unless it's specially protected. Right, old story, and we tried this on keylog remote controls, and as promised, inside the keylog remote controls, there is a counter. This number goes into the keylog cipher, which is, by the way, also mathematically weak cipher. And out comes the rolling code, and we are after this secret key, 64-bit secret key that is used for the encryption. So what we do is we record several rolling codes, several ciphertexts, and we know the algorithm. We know it's a key log algorithm. It's important to know which algorithm is used here. And then, so we don't need a plain text, that's the message. Yeah? Plain text is not needed, and we record some traces, some power traces with an oscilloscope, evaluated statistically on a PC, and out comes the cryptographic key of the remote control. Great, so let's try it, and we tried it, and management summary, it's possible to clone such a remote control by pressing 10 times on the device and recording 10 power traces, and then you have the 64-bit key of this remote control. Wow. Yeah. Yeah, it's not so scary, isn't it? Because you can do the same with mechanical keys, and it's like the cleaning woman scenario. So now that someone already has physical access to this key, then the cleaning woman goes to her side channel lab, performs this very complicated attack, and then finally she has a copy and she can come back whenever she wants. Or you might want to do it in a car rental scenario and stuff like that. But it's not very impressive. It's not very like groundbreaking, and so we said there must be more to it, and we were looking for a purely wireless attack, and we found it because in case of keylog they're using a manufacturer key, and the cool thing about manufacturer key is that you can get it from only one power measurement, without plain text, without ciphertext, and this manufacturer key is in every receiver of one manufacturer. So say you want to be able to attack the garage door opener Super 3000, then you need to go to the warehouse, you buy one receiver, you take the one power measurement, extract the manufacturer key, and then you return the receiver to the shop, and you have the manufacturer key. And now with the knowledge of this manufacturer key, you can compute the individual keys of the various remote controls. Huh? So in keylog, in this keylog scheme, every remote control has a different cryptographic key, but it is derived from the serial number of this remote control and the manufacturer key. So knowing the manufacturer key, where is the serial number coming from? Aha, if I press this button, the remote control will send the serial number in clear. So me as an attacker, I have the serial number, I have the manufacturer key, so now I can compute the secret key of this remote control and I can clone it. That's of course a more impressive attack because you can do it from the wireless internet, wireless interface. You don't need, you don't leave any physical traces and you have a copy of this remote control, no? And we were, back in 2008, we were very upset. We said, this is a single point of failure. How can someone implement something so badly? And yeah, we were not so well experienced yet with what people are doing in the world. And we thought, this is shocking. It must be publicized. And we also showed it on television here with Christoph. That's Mark Harrigan. Christoph, my PhD father, we call it. We park in front of the garage unconspicuously, and the victim is coming, and the victim is opening this garage. And inside this laptop is now the manufacturer key. We have monitored the code of the remote control. Victim is closing garage again. It's raining. Car is still open. Television. And then we are computing now the device key of the remote control of the victim. And now we can open the garage, and then we can walk into the garage and put something into the garage. Whatever you do when you open the garage. So now you guys say, why is Timo boring us with this old boring stuff from 2008? Yeah, that's a good question. Well, meanwhile, attackers have changed. And the things using keylog have also changed. Here I brought, by the way, this lock. This is an electronic lock. I brought it for demonstration purposes, and it's using keylog. No, so you can stick it to your mechanical door lock, and then you can use this remote control to open or close it, like this. And yeah, what works quite good is assembly to this mechanical cylinder. It works quite well, so you can stick it on. And the rest as well, I cannot really recommend it. Neither of the function of this remote control nor the overall behavior. I don't like it very much. That's why I use it here for demonstration purposes. So this is the door lock. This is the remote control. And here's the attacker. Attacker in 2016. He looks like this. I put it here so you can see him. Attacker. And now imagine I have to play two roles now. Imagine I am at home and I go in the morning, I leave my house and I close my door. I close it, and you might have noticed the attacker has now already a copy of my remote control, right? I let the remote control here. I'm now gone, I'm at work. Attacker is still here. The attacker comes and he opens the door for me, not for him. Opens the door and he goes inside, he does something, I don't know. Take something from my fridge, and he leaves again. He closes the door again, and he's gone. Oh. Okay, I said I leave no traces, no physical traces. Now, what happens? The attacker is gone. My door is locked. It looks all fine. I come back home, and I open my door. So those guys, now, who has understood the rolling codes? What will happen now if I press on this remote control? It will not work, right? How often do I have to? Why? Because the receiver still has the old counter of this remote control. It has already the new counter of the attacker. It has a new number of this remote control. But my remote control is still some three codes behind. No, so the first time, nothing happens. Second time, nothing happens. And only on the third press, the door will react again because it catches up with the, or maybe on the fourth. It catches up with the signal. So you see, this is also complicated, copying rolling code remote controls. No, if you make a copy, it's kind of difficult to operate, no? So, okay, and so that's what the attacker looks like today, like this, for example. And now it's 2016, and I'm boring you with the stuff from 2008. And the reason is that there is still lots of rolling codes out there on the streets currently. And that's what we publicized this year on this year's USENIX conference in Austin, in Texas. you all know this, or not all, but you might know these lock it or lose it signs that are on the parking spaces that tell you that to lock your car and watch how the turn lights are flashing to make sure that your car is really locked, and then leave the car space, whatever. And that's why we call the paper lock it and still lose it. Huh? Even if you lock it and watch it, you can still lose it. And it's about the remotive keyless entry systems. Here's a selection of the affected manufacturers, and this USENIX paper is basically is only the tip of the iceberg. You know, it's responsible disclosure. It's a very complicated process, but this is what could be publicized so far. And the paper is only about the remote control part that requires a user interaction. So you need to press a button that something happens. It's not about the keyless entry. That's already correct with this. Relay attack, man in the middle attack. It's not about the mechanical stuff, it's not about the immobilizer. Immobilizers are already cracked, but it's only about opening the door and switching off the alarm, which is the interesting part, no? Because opening the door, you can also smash the window or open it mechanically, but with this remote control, you also deactivate the alarm system. That's the whole idea. And in the following, I will quickly summarize why all these remote controls can be copied from a distance, from wirelessly, just like I just showed with this door lock. The same applies to these cars. Let me start with this demo video. This is my car, VW Passat, quite a good car, I like it. However, now I start locking it mechanically, because this demonstration might remind you of this lock. It's basically the same, so I open and close the car, and now for the attack, it's sufficient to monitor one remote control signal. And after this, this is the attacker. Very severe. He looks funny, this attacker. And he has eavesdropped one signal, and now from eavesdropping one signal, he can clone the original remote control and now open and close the VW car. No? So it's basically the same demo as with this lock, but the room was too small to bring my car, so I brought this lock instead to show it and show the video that it also applies to the cars, no? So now I'm pressing the car key, not four times, but five times until the lights of the car flash again. Hmm? So why is this possible for VW cars? First of all, affected cars are these. Affected cars are basically all VW, Seat, Skoda, and some Audi cars manufactured between 1995 and 2016 today. Yeah? And there are a few new cars, so there are a few people. If you own a really brand new car that is based on the Golf 7 modular Querbaukasten platform, then there is something new, implemented something new that is, according to the manufacturer, our attacks do not apply to this, right? We have not verified this, but so it applies to about 20 years, all cars manufactured in 20 years. That's a surprise. And what they are doing is, you can imagine there is a VW Golf coming out of the factory, and there is a cryptographic key put into this VW. And there comes the next car in the factory, and they put the same secret into the next car. And then comes the next car in the factory, and they put the same key into this car. So they end up with millions of cars sharing the same global secret cryptographic key, okay? Even my grandmother can tell this is not a good way to keep things secret, yeah? And it's really, I still cannot explain how this is possible in the year 2016. I said 2008, we said, wow, keylog, such a single point of failure with the manufacturer keys. I mean, in this case, each remote control at least had some individual secret and you needed to extract some manufacturer key. And now, if you know five or six worldwide secrets, you can copy the remote controls. While at the same time, they have improved the ciphers. So they use four or five different ciphers, and they are improving. So the last cipher they were using is XTIA, and XTIA is okay. It's absolutely fine using this cipher for the rolling codes. It would be absolutely unbreakable. This attack would not be possible if they just had a good key distribution. Yeah, that's how the really big people do it. And the others, the high-tech two part, you know, there's NXP, and you all know that the high-tech two cipher has turned out to be broken. It's a weak cipher. And here's Flavio Garcia with his Alfa Romeo Giulietta, and he's now capturing eight codes of his car, which is more than one code, but it's still practical. They don't need to be consecutive, but you just need eight codes of this car, and then he can start his attack on the laptop. and it's now cracking the keys. It's still working on it. So you see it requires a little bit more computational power, but that's it now. The key has been extracted. It can be transferred to this Arduino. Flavio is using this $40 Arduino device with some RF shield on it. And now he can open and close his car with this Arduino. So this high-tech 2 attack, it is possible because of the weak high-tech 2 cipher. And in the high-tech 2 scheme, each car and remote control have individual secrets. No? Not like in Volkswagen, but in this case, it's the weak cipher that makes the attacks possible. And it applies to various manufacturers and various cars. And it's always hard to test attacks. If you ask your friend, can I damage your car, please? And then he will probably say no. And it's difficult to test many cars. And these are only the tested cars. But the list of affected cars is, of course, longer. When we found this these Volkswagen things, I usually tested going on to a shop, a big parking space of a supermarket, and I knew, oh, this car, I'm not sure if this car is really working, and then I watched the person locking it, and then I lock it again, I make sure that it's really locked, and I see that the turn lights flash, and then I know, yes, the attack applies, it's all fine. So just I wanted to make sure not to destroy something, not to send two codes, so I just lock it again to make sure it's really locked, and I could see whether it's compatible or not, because most people love their car so much that they will not let some long-haired researcher investigate something. Okay, to summarize once more, so VW has chosen for a key management to choose fixed keys, worldwide fixed keys. And so it's possible to instantly copy a remote control from one eavesdrop signal, because you receive one code and you have to try five secrets, and then you will see if you were successful to decode the signal. And you have a clone of this remote control from a distance and can access the car and its alarm systems. So this is highly practical and scalable. That's also why we, after a while, decided to publicize it, because there's always two sides of a coin. You don't want to give instructions to attackers and to thieves. On the other hand, it's obvious that this is so easy and so clear that it will be used. And we already saw indicators that this is used by criminals. And on the other hand, we have high-tech 2, which has diversified keys. Each car has an individual secret. But they're using the weak cipher. So this is, you remember from the beginning, the two attack options. Yeah, above, on top is attacking the key management. This was easy in this case. And below is attacking the cipher. Yeah? And if these high-tech 2 cars had used, say, XTIA instead of high-tech 2, would be completely fine, huh? It would be fine. Other way around too. If Volkswagen used the key distribution scheme of the high-tech 2 cars, it would also be fine. So, summary: crypto is bad. Poor crypto is bad, but poor key management is worse. Yeah, clearly. And we all know better, and we need to find some way to get it in the industry. Probably it helps to publicize these results, and then there will be some television shows about it, and bet, and the insurance will rise. And that's probably when the manufacturers react, and they will improve the security. And in a few years, we will have it's not so complicated, no, to make a secure remote control. Right. There is more. There's not only access to doors, but there's also access to computers. Computers, that's your topic, no? And as you know, some people log onto Windows with only a passport, and there's this trend going to authentication with knowledge plus something that you possess. No? So two-factor authentication. And there are various options for this, and one option was this RSA, Secure ID Token, but this was already hacked in 2011, so it's not an option anymore. So we said, let's analyze this YubiKey2 token, which is a one-time password. You plug it into your PC, you press on this golden button, and so you first type a username, then you type your password, then you plug in this token, press on the button, and it will type a one-time password into the fields, and then you can log in. And we said, this is interesting, let's analyze it. And so what happens if you record the data, if you press the button, you can see something that is constant. This is like a serial number at the beginning, and then comes the encrypted part at the end. Yeah? So you see on the left side the serial number, on the right side some encrypted part, and now this encrypted part is basically also a rolling code. Yeah? So there is a counter, it's a little bit more, but it's basically there is a counter this counter is encrypted, this time with AES, and then yeah, we said, why should we not show that side channel attacks are also possible on AES? Because from educational point of view, it was bad to attack keylog, because keylog was mathematically weak. So we said we also want to show AES is also attackable, because it's hard to get it through to the minds of the executive directors. So we took the YubiKey, and this time we used an electromagnetic attack. You can see the probe. It's close to the chip inside the YubiKey, and we have to record. So I have to steal your YubiKey, and then I need 1 hour access to take 700 electromagnetic measurements, and then I can make a copy of your YubiKey. Yeah? So. Which is okay. I still need to install a key logger or so on your PC, because I still need your username and password in order to impersonate you. But it's the purpose of this token is then if after I had 1 hour physical access, it is it's broken. And this was a good example. The company Yubico was very nice and like very different from other, because we have a lot of experience with this responsible disclosure and speaking with companies. And most companies are very upset when you tell them about security vulnerabilities. And this company was like, wow, great, you found a security vulnerability, you know, good job. What can we do about it? No, and this was the way how we like it. They just ask, hey, what can we do about it? Improve the firmware, and then the newly produced YubiKeys, they have a protection against this, and they are not, I think probably the attacks are still possible, but probably you need to measure 10 years and it's out of the scope of a practical attack. No, so that's also how it can be, how this circle can work in a good way. You know, it must not always end like in the case of Megamos in front of the court. Sorry, I'm a little bit ill, as you might have noticed. I usually don't have a voice like Johnny Cash, but it's because of this flu, so there's no beer, so. Right, one step forward, let's forget about rolling codes. The next things we want to discuss are only challenge response, only state of the art. Both, we don't save money on the receiver and transmitter anymore. Both sides can receive and transmit, both the car and the car key. And they have cryptography, and the car sends a challenge, as you all know this, and the car and the remote control encrypts this challenge, this random number, to send back the response R to the car. The car can do the same computations because it knows the same cryptographic key K, and then the car can verify whether the remote control knows the same secret without that the secret is sent over the insecure channel, over this wireless channel, right? Of course, this has to be extended for a mutual authentication, and always, I have to repeat this, challenges have to be random and long enough, because you don't want people can predict the challenges, and no one should be able to create a table with challenges and responses. This, it's funny that many of us know this, and still, it seems to be very hard to implement this nicely in embedded systems. Probably it's really hard to generate good random in something that is, say, a contactless card which has no battery. How should it generate a good random number? So it's still complicated in the embedded world to create good randomness and good challenges. So one thing where this is used are contactless cards. Contactless cards, they are standardized in some ISO 14443 or ISO 15693. ISO 15693 is this one for your skiing tickets. If you go from Vienna to the Alps and you want to go skiing, they usually have no encryption features, the 15693 cards, but have a little bit longer reading range. And the ISO 14443 cards are, for example, the NXP's MyFair family, where you have here the MyFair Deathfire, MyFair Classic, MyFair Ultralight, and they require, all these contactless cards require a reader, so-called reader. It generates a strong field, and the field is not only for communication, but also for powering these contactless cards, because they have no battery. And the energy today, the energy of such a reader is completely sufficient that these cards can do complex cryptographic operations. So energy is no issue here. It's possible to do elliptic curve cryptography. That's what your passport is doing to secure your fingerprints. And Deathfire cards, they can do AES, triple S. So all modern cryptography is possible on cryptographic cards, just a matter of cost probably. And yeah, these contactless cards are used in access control systems. They must not always look like contactless cards, but they can also look like key tokens. Oh, by the way, here's the latest recycling product, waste product of the Usenix security attack is my new presenter from Kasper&Oswald. It's this car key. All the time I'm using this car key for the presentation. This is the receiver. Instead of this, Logitech device, I prefer to use my Opel key because they close Opel and I use this. The only problem is that when the car is outside, then it's always opening and closing during the presentation. So there is a problem marketing it, but it's still great what good products, good research can make. No? I was jumping. This technology is also in electronic passports, in your Visa, VPay card, if you have got such symbol on it. It's also compatible to this ISO 14443 standard of contactless cards and for various ticketing purposes. No? This was a world championship in Germany, my diploma thesis, do a relay attack on these world championship tickets, 2006. Huh? 2016, they look in the television, oh, they do relay attacks on cars, we have to secure our cars. How could this happen? Oh. And this is in London, the Oyster card, in Prague, the Open card, in Singapore, EasyLink card. They all have contactless cards according to ISO 14443. And also if you have a smartphone, now it's really happening. Years and years ago, Leila, when 10 or 15 years ago, when they invented the NFC, we always thought, now soon there will be lots of smartphones out there using this technology. But actually it took, I thought it would never happen, but now it looks like there's really lots of smartphones out that use this that have a near field communication interface. And this is also compatible to the ISO 14443 standard. The ISO 14443 is the mother, and the NFC just combines a lot of these standards, like the type B, type C, type D, and ISO 15693. So if you have an NFC smartphone, it's also compatible to this, and that's why it's worth listening to the following stuff. As you know, one insecure example was my Fair Classic card. It was broken a long time ago, 2008, and we were using it in our university in the student identity cards in Bochum. We had this card, and I did a security analysis on these cards, and it was enough for a nice paper on financial cryptography. Tenerife was also nice. All you PhD students, make sure you choose the nice locations like Vienna and maybe with beach, more or less beach. And this paper is all you can eat paper. It's about the payment function that is integrated in our student ID card. So you can charge the student ID card with 150 euros. Up to 150 euros. Most students don't have 150 euros. And you can open doors with it of student dormitories, or you can use washing machine, wash your clothes with it. And they were using My Fair Classic card. So we said, wow, My Fair Classic card, let's attack it. Huh? And and the commercial readers were slow. Kind of slow. It always took me 7 or 8 hours to extract the My Fair Classic key with available text. So back then I built my own reader, and it took 30 seconds per key. I was very happy, extracted the keys of my car, took David's card, extracted his keys, and they were the same keys. This reminds us of Volkswagen, no? And took the next student's ID card, and they were exactly the same keys in this card again. So they seem to have the same security advisor as Volkswagen. And this is an invitation for fraud, of course. No? So all the cards in the University of Bochum turn out to have the same cryptographic keys using my weak My Fair Classic cards. What an invitation for the... But yeah, students usually are not evil, but we did security analysis for the university for free, and we also investigated what are the possible attacks. So we were eating a lot, no? Or eating a lot for free ice cream, and we got the permission to do it. Because this reader, I reprogram it to, it always wrote 100, it tries to write 100 euros to a car, and in case of success, the LED will turn green. And so we had this, I prepare some slides, I prepare to the university, hey, you have a security problem here, executive director, blah, blah, sitting there, and they were very bored. They said, okay, it seems very interesting, Mr. Kasper. And then he shows his own identity card, and he asks, is this also vulnerable? And I said, hang on, I can test it, and I wave it on the antenna, light is green. I said, yes, it is vulnerable, and you now have 100 euro on the card. And he was like, because it was too quick for him. We went to a restaurant, tested to the cash register, And he asked, how much money is there on it? And the lady said, one moment, 100 euro. And then we were running out. He opens a door on the way. And he said, Mr. Kasper, I have understood. We have security problem. We don't tell the... Yeah. Before 20 slides, everything was explained. We don't tell the technical personnel. We tell no one. We have to find out what's going on here. You can eat as much as you like. Just give me an update. And after like 1 week, I called him. I said, I don't fit into the elevator anymore. I'm already getting too big. We have to stop experiment. The whole chair was helping. It was nice research. And we found that it would be very evil if an attacker would now, he could bump, run into people and charge their credit to 0 euro. That would be evil, no? What would happen is customer would go to the customer desk and there would be a lot of customer service efforts. Yeah? But the attack, it would be evil, but it would be, you can cope with this type of attack. You could also automatize it. So the reading range is about 30 centimeters and it takes 20 milliseconds to write on the sector. So if you, for example, at the waiting queue in front of the cash register, if you install the hidden reader there, then it is feasible to upload a few cards without people wanting, upload, yes, that's the nice attacker. Upload something, no, not write 0 euros, but put some not so obvious money, not 100 euros, but put 46.30 euro onto the card of the people, and they will not even notice, even if they don't want to cheat, if they don't want to commit fraud, they will have some more money on the card. They might not even notice, or they might notice and not think about it, whatever. And this would be the bad attack, because people then don't pay money into the systems, but they spend it, and this, the only solution would be if this would be done on a large scale to shut down the system. Yeah, my favorite attack was this, you can also get anonymous cards. So I had to pay 10 euros refund. And then I got an empty card. I went around the corner and I wrote 50 euros to the card. And 2 hours later, I went to another cash desk and I said, I don't need this car anymore. I want to give it back. And it worked. The lady gave me the 60 euros and it's the wet dreams of the cryptographers. No, convert zeros and ones to cash. So this is the what we call the digital cash cow, digitaler Goldesel. Huh? In case of unemployment, we can still come back to this option. And this was also 2000, financial cryptography 2009. And so I said, okay, in 2014, 2 years already. I said, 5 years later, I said, okay, I come back to my university and I have a look what they have been doing, because they got my security analysis for free and I wanted to see what this company Intracard has now done. And yes, they are now selling the more expensive DESFA EV1 cards. They have exchanged all readers for the more expensive DESFA EV1 compatible readers. And yes, they have now a back end with shadow accounts, and they are still checked manually. So there is still no automatic alarm triggered when you pay with a card. And of course, the old Mafia Classic cards still work. And as the University of Bochum has many long-term students who don't give back their cards and no one pays for exchanging the cards, it's still possible to perform various attacks. And this is a typical example, Volkswagen or this, if you deploy something in a flawed way, it's so hard to repair it, hard to impossible, no? Because who is taking all the cost to exchange all cards and readers? It's impossible. So it's good to think about it, to think about the security before deploying it. Otherwise, even today, people like this are seen on the University of Bochum. Beautiful. We don't have the highest suicide rate. This is wrong. This was wrong news. This is the cash machine. Usually there's a long queue in front of this where you can charge your payment card. And it was very complicated to get credit onto this card. You had to insert money or insert your credit card and type some PIN code and so. And yes, you can see the queue is now gone because we have greatly simplified this process of uploading the money. You can see each time you press on the button of this device, you get 10 euros more, and so it depends how hungry is the attacker, so how much trouble will be done. Yeah? This looks like a very hungry attacker. And the device I was showing there is the Chameleon Mini. It's already a long, long time research product. It also originates from my diploma thesis 2006. And it does not appear as a contactless card optically, but for an RFID reader, it appears as a normal MiFair Classic card. Or any contactless card. Historically, it started 2006 with my diploma thesis. So this was the first working RFID transponder back in 2006. And this was in the context of the relay attack. So there was no intelligence on this part of the transponder. As you can see, there's not much intelligence, but it was working. And soon I made my homebrew PCB. And I was so happy that it fits into the packet of cigarettes and could be worn unconspicuously. And it took a long time. University is slow, even slower than industry. 2011, I found bachelor student Ingo, and I told him, okay, make the Chameleon work autonomously. And I created the hardware for him, and he put a new firmware there, and we used this at Atmel ATX Mega as the core, and Ingo gave it some life so that it could emulate MiFair Classic cards with the Crypto One cipher, MiFair Desfire ML3 ICD40 cards with the triple des. You know, I can say this so fluent because after we did the side channel attack on the Deathfire ML3 ICD40 cards, I always had to say ML3 ICD40 instead of EV1. Of course, the Chameleon can also do the EV1. And in this stage, we had authenticated the authentication of both cards for the paper. And first, it didn't work. And we thought, and we found that the Chameleon was too fast. And we had to wait a little bit after the cryptographic operations to answer when the real Deathfire card would also answer. So it was already working very well, but people were always laughing at me and said, because of this homebrew appearance of the card, and it was already like 2015, and they said, what is Timo using here? This looks like 1980s. So we said, it's time for a redesign, and we had a look what we could do to improve this Chameleon, and we crossed out here all components that were not required in the redesign. So we found that there is quite a lot of stuff inside the microcontroller that can take over these tasks of these external components. And we ended up with a revision D, which was exactly the size of credit card. And as you can see, the electronics had moved inside the circuitry, which was a bit risky because there is this strong reader field here, and we were scared that it will affect the electronic circuitry, but there was no problem. It worked really fine. And my son, Misha, he lives in Prague. He was very interested in RFID security. So I explained everything to him, and he's using it now for the first time. And even if it's very simple technology, it wants some time practicing until it works for the first time, you see? But he's getting there. You can also see this revision D still needed a battery, which was very annoying. You see, it falls out, it's on the ground, it was... So Misha very much likes this technology, and he cannot be prosecuted. This is in the technical... There is the guard is... So there is a guard sitting here on the right-hand side, and his job is to verify that no fraud is committed and that everything works fine. So Misha is very unconspicuously a little child with this green thing, and the guard sees the light is green. When the light is green, of course, everything is fine. The guard has been doing his job. No fraud has been committed. The light is green. Yeah? Like this, like in the Mensa in the student restaurant, the lady where I pay with the Chameleon, and she says, it's not a car. I says, no, it's not a car, but she was still happy because the money is gone. Yeah, you can also, in Prague, there is also a Mensa. I need to forward a bit. There's also a Mensa, and you can also pay there, but there it's even worse than in Bochum because they really just verify the UID, only the number of this MiFair Classic card. So Misha copies the card of his mother here, and she has 1,500 crowns, but he doesn't want to steal from his mother, so he creates a random UID, and he gets the card of Martin Novotny. He still has 1,036 crowns. That should be enough for a nice lunch. And also, not only children are happy, but also adults. And David shows here in the Hotel Ibis, they use a so-called Fink card system. This has been bought by Assa Abloy, and they simply use MiFair Ultralight cards. And as you know, they can be easily copied. And you can see how happy is an adult to use a Chameleon instead of his real door card to access his room. No? So it's so easy to make everyone happy. There was only one problem with the revision D. We thought it's a good idea, and then to put the electronics inside. And then came the students and said, we cannot wash our clothes anymore. I said, why? And it turns out that the washing machines, they have got in the university, they have got a slot, and you have to insert the card into this slot very far, and there's a switch at the end of the slot. And only when this switch is hit, the card is read out. And now they try to insert the revision D, and it stopped here because of this. So they could not insert the whole card. So we said, of course, guys, we understand this, the market demand, we will react. And we reacted with this breakable antenna part. So now the electronics is outside again. And you can see here, this is the full length of the credit card. Huh? And this is an option, one-time break-off parts. This is basically for washing clothes in this device. And if you don't need it, you break it off, and it's again the size of a credit card. In addition, also Revision G now provides this external data flash, so it can store up to 8 different cards. And it has some improved command set. So everyone, you all have this man's wallet with all these 8 contactless cards. And now you don't need it anymore. You save a lot of space in your purse. You can see this holy shine above the Chameleon. There's a lot of legal good purposes of Chameleon. Like when I was in parental holiday in Aveiro in Portugal, very nice there. I was invited for a talk. They had these readers. Not without this green thing, but if you see such a reader, so at several times in Europe, they only use the UID of the My Fair Classic card, and then if you obtain the UID of these cards, you can already copy them, and then as people expect of me videos with barriers, I also made a video with barriers there because I was there with my big car, I needed to park somewhere and sleep somewhere and get a shower somewhere. And so to have a nice accommodation for my family, I opened the barrier with Chameleon and I parked there. And of course, this card also opens the laboratory and other offices inside the faculty. In Aveiro, it's such that you cannot enter the building without a valid RFID card. So I went to the to the registration desk and asked the lady, wow, this is very modern. You have RFID technology. Can I have one of these cards? It's very interesting for me. And the lady was very nice. She gave me the card. I took it to my reader. I read out the serial number. And it turns out to be a card, like kind of MasterCard, that can open all the barriers in all the rooms. No, so thank you. This is some lack of... they should know that only the serial number is used, probably. Yeah, you can also do, I don't know if you have this here, and that's why we don't have the coal dust in Bochum, because we're using bicycles these days. It works that you can rent this bicycle, you have to put the number of the bicycle into this RFID-operated machine. And the funny, it's really funny, because then it gives you the number of this combination lock that secures the bicycle. And then you can unsecure the bicycle, and you can rent it for a while, and the Chameleon is basically charged, no? And yeah, you must not forget to put the lock and the Chameleon into the bicycle, and don't be scared. Of course, we also, David is never stealing bicycles, he always returns them and gives it back. But so in this case, the My Fair Classic cards have the key FFFFF, and you need to know or guess a valid UID to borrow a bicycle for a while at no cost. Did you have problems with the bicycle? Yeah. One last video. I sent one Chameleon for free to Russia. There was a guy who had little money. He said, I received 2 bottles of vodka and a kitchen magnet. And this video, how he's using in Moscow metro, he's using the Chameleon to enter the gateway to the Moscow metro, because they're using My Fair Ultralight cards. Long story, now comes the Revision F. We have upgraded the data flash to an FRAM. Reason was because it was not available anymore, so we said we go for the very new technology, and we put it on Kickstarter, crowdfunding. We said we want 22,222 euros to make it happen. At the end, we had 190,000 and almost 2,000 backers. So we produced about 5,000 Chameleons, and meanwhile, about 2,000 Chameleons have been sent out. It's really worldwide. I think there is no country in the world that has not ordered a Chameleon. It's in Malaysia, in Singapore, in China, Indonesia, all countries of Europe. And they all now possess a Chameleon Revision G. What is cool about Revision G, what we had developed, is that it has now also a reader integrated. So before, the Chameleon was only emulating cards, but now it also generates a reader field and can read out the other cards. So before you always needed an additional RFID reader for several things, and now everything can be put onto this Chameleon. And the logging functionality has been improved. This is a nice feature to log the data because you cannot see what a door lock and the car is speaking. No one can see this, can you? And you never know, I've seen some door locks. They are MyFair, Desfair, EV1 door locks. And they have expensive, that's for EV. And what really happens is they only look for the UID, they only look for the serial number of the card and never perform any cryptographic authentication, nothing. And usually you don't see this. You have a good feeling using this Desfair EV1 card, but there's never the authentication used. And yeah, I think it's time for another, there's still enough time for a quick live demo of Chameleon. What can go wrong? Goes wrong, so for the live demo, I always have a Chameleon here. It's now a battery operated, as you can see, ta-da. Battery is on the back, recharges when plugging in USB. And I use for demonstration purposes this SCL3711 reader. It's not very good, but it's small, so I plug this in. And now I need to open, hang on, I need to open some command line. And the terminal, I start with the terminal. So we plug in the Chameleon to the PC. And we have invented a both user-friendly and PC-friendly interface. So you can always operate the Chameleon as a human, or as you can also script it. So the language is completely scriptable and computer-readable, but it's also human, can be operated by a human, by me. So I connected this, and then now I can speak with the Chameleon. I can ask, what is your version? Can you still see this at the back of the room? Okay. Or what commands do you know? These are the available commands. Or I can say, I want to upload a card. I want to upload Mensa card. I type upload. I already have the dump of my Mensa card here. Xmodem is very cool for transmitting binary files. And now this card, now the Chameleon is supposedly emulating my Ruhr University Bochum Mensa card. So let's verify it with the SCL3711 reader. Sorry, it is a bit like only command line, but it should be sufficient. So if I put command NFC list here, and I put my Mensa card on top of the, this is the wrong one, NFC list. And it shows, this is a MyFair Classic card with the UID 44F0, blah, blah, blah. You cannot see what I'm doing. It's not so important. You have to believe me. I'm now holding the Chameleon to the reader, in front of the reader, and I'm asking what it is. It's not answering. It's the same card number, and you have to believe me, it's not only the card number, but the whole content of the card is now copied onto the Chameleon. And now if I'm in Portugal, I could also configure the slots, of course, as MyFair Classic, MyFair Ultra. This is currently implemented. And in the project, people are currently working on the Desfair EV1 implementation. And next is to come the Legic Prime and HID iClass cards and all cards that can be cracked. This will be done in the open source project. Our idea was to avoid problems that we distribute a hardware with nothing on it and a test firmware. And then there is this open source project, right? Open source project. And there, some things will be developed. I don't know if people will develop attacks there or other cards, or if there will be some copyright on what people implement. I cannot influence it. It's the internet. I cannot switch off the internet. Cannot switch off this open source project and all its mirrors. So currently, there's a lot of stuff going on in this open source project. And I can, the UID was this one. If I'm now in Portugal, I can set the UID to a UID I like. For example, UID 123456789. Then, just to show you that it's really easy to operate, and can again ask the card, hey, who are you? And it says, I'm a card with the UID 123456789. As said, it's also operating battery operated without the cable. And there is also a new function which I implemented in my firmware. So this is the Moscow Metro card, MyFair Ultralight, and it has no cryptography. And now if I press on the left button, it's hopefully is configured correctly. So if the red light flashes twice, the card has been copied. Now this card has been copied to the Chameleon. Let's verify it. First I hold the Chameleon to the reader. So this is the UID card emulated by Chameleon, and now comes the Moscow Metro card. Ah, look, it's the same card. Wow, this was complicated to copy. So I hope this will help NXP to sell more crypto cards in the future. And last but not least, I said that the data can be locked and written by the Chameleon, and this is also something I can quickly show you. Cam lock, this should do. I just have to close the terminal first, because otherwise there will be a problem. Can someone see the mouse there? Close. So this is a Python script that loads down the log file and already interprets it. And you can see the conversation that has been taking place today in our experiments. For those who are into the RFID topic, they can probably read this. For the others, I can explain what is going on. So we have here, this is a request command, request R. So is someone here? And this is the answer to request. Yes, there is someone here. And the reader says, anti-collision, all cards in my field, please give me your UID. The Mensa card was giving its UID 44F0, sending back. And now the reader says, I select you card with the identifier 44F0. And you can always see during the communication, you always have a global timestamp. And you have a relative timestamp, so you can see if something takes a long time, if someone implemented something wrong. For example, we had a customer for public transport. They sometimes had to wait 2 seconds for a car to be read out, and we could easily figure out when this happened. And you can see the direction here, transmit or receive. And so you can see this conversation stopped, and then there was another conversation with the Chameleon, and this is all dirt, and there came also the ultralight. This was what I wanted to demonstrate about the Chameleon, and I come back to the talk. There's also creative usage of the Chameleon at the University of Bochum. Florian Bache, you can see he connected some cables to the Vision E. And installed it into some setup, university lab setup. And as a result, what most people don't know is he created a tag that can be read out from 70 centimeters. This is at the same time the first positive usage I've ever seen of this book. Yeah, it's the first time that this book was useful, because it increases the reading range by about 4 or 5 centimeters, as you can see. So the antenna's at the bottom. Antennas connected to Chameleon. It's an interesting setup, but the Chameleon can set out in this funny thing for 70 centimeters, and in the meantime, even more is possible. This can be interesting if you have, say, a cash machine or something, and there is a video camera, and you want to monitor the person, and there can be, and you assume that he must be very close to the reader, but in fact, he can be quite far away. So this is an interesting result. Another interesting result was presented in last year's CES by Georg. So he showed how the Chameleon can clone physically unclonable functions. Poof, yeah? I always like the poof, so I even like more that the Chameleon clones a physically unclonable function. So if you're interested, you should read Georg's paper on CES 2015, how this works. And there's some more things to tell, but for the first time in my life, I want to finish in time and let you go to the lunch. So I just click on this man, on this man. Oh, something is happening. And I come to my last slide. How to secure the Internet of Things. I hope you have seen that implementation attacks are an important threat. Of course, you should not educate your attacker by deploying weak products, but first think about it and make a really good thing before you let it into the field. Yeah, what you can do against the sidechain and implementation attacks is you can use these certified products. However, okay, it's still not 100% security. It's also very important to have some countermeasures on the system level and have a good backend, for example, for these MiFair Classic cards and the payment system. It would be easy to implement some automated check of the cash registers that say, please go to the customer service, give back your cards, and always expect the unexpected. This is always my very last slide. You can see this. Okay. Thank you for your attention. So if there are questions, I'm still available here. If you're hungry, just go ahead and have a... I will still be here the next 2 days and you can find me. I'm the blonde-haired guy with this, yeah.
Only one question.
One question.
Didn't you have any kind of trouble with the distribution of the chameleon?
The question was whether I had any kind of trouble with the distribution of the chameleon. No.
No, legal problems. Someone.
Some problems in general. No, because I think so. I mean, we expected some problems with.